a lot of the promise, a lot of the expectations of what we're going to be doing with 5G, with the next generation, in the 5G era, but obviously the promises of capacity and latency and the new services have to be enabled by some folks, which is why I'm happy to be now having a panel of basically industry suppliers, ecosystem players, who will talk a bit about how we take some of those promises, the stuff that we heard about this morning, and maybe put it into context and make it real. So with that, let me take my seat and we can bring on our panelists. Thank you, please. Now look at that, in order. So we've only got 18 minutes and a little bit of extra time, so I'm not going to take too much time introducing folks here, but we've got Asha from Intel, Bijoy from Mavenir, and Ricky from Nokia. Thank you guys for joining me today.
Pleasure,
we've heard a lot about the promise of what we can do with next generation technologies from an enterprise side of things from some great speakers today. But let me just take a quick step back and we'll start. Obviously, you all can chime in, but we'll start with you, Asha. When you come to a conference like this, right, we hear all these promises, and I think across all of the sessions this morning, we heard, you know, here's what we're going to do with latency, and we're going to leverage things like AI and IoT, and 5G is going to help us do all these things. And to some extent, it can seem a bit like a cliche, right? Like, look, everyone just uses these terms together. And I think I saw it was a prominent VC who tweeted that any time he hears someone talk about AI, IoT, and smart cities, he knows they don't know what they're talking about, right? Because it's just throwing out some jargon there. But from your perspective, obviously what you guys are doing at Intel, you've been doing a lot on the 5G front, you've been doing a lot on the AI front. Is there a way to pull those all together? Does it make sense to pull those all together? Or are they really disparate things that shouldn't be talked about as a cliche?
So actually, it's a really great question. And I think even the use cases for all of these technologies are similar. And the reason they all kind of get munched together or they're intersecting is because the promise of 5G is the things that enable a fully connected mobile intelligent society. What they all have in common is data and networks. And so the way I think of how we pull this all together is we power the network. Like Intel used to power PCs, then the cloud, and the network. And because we have all of these together, and I love Tammy's 8 currencies, so you can start cutting the wire when you have like latency and flexibility with the reliability, which means the AI then uses those pipes to build personalization and customization. And then we remove constraints to businesses. And then there's like AI, which edge, I guess our edge is the edge. So sure. I think they all just come together.
I mean, Bijoy, Ricky, are you seeing that from your customers, from operators? Are they seeing how those all come together to do what they want to do?
Sure. First of all, thanks for the opportunity. I think as Tammy and Sprint also mentioned, 5G is not just a new generation. It's a think of it as a network transformation. So every time you're talking about network transformation, a bunch of things needs to come together to make it happen. So if you look at how operators have to transform themselves from just being communication service providers to the digital service providers, as was presented earlier, you're going through a network transformation that stage. So infrastructure transition to web scale, cultural changes within the organization, and then as a technology and as you're playing new roles in the value chain, that means you need to take care of things like AI, which is going to play a significant role, especially you're talking about Industry 4.0. Artificial intelligence of things then becomes very key, especially as you go forward into 2020. So we see what we call these two AAAs, the AI, the artificial intelligence, the analytics, and automation. These three things as key elements to make 5G successful.
Yeah, look, I think from a Nokia perspective, you know, we are building these networks. And if you take a step back and think about our history in this through Bell Labs, you know, we helped define the architecture around 5G. And so you see all this stuff coming together. And we're in a very unique position of being someone who provides actually all those elements in the network today. And the challenge really is how do we bring that together and actually make it work? Because it is complex, it is new. And things have come together at a point now where through artificial intelligence and through orchestration, we can actually start to make these things real and move data and loads around the network seamlessly, where in the past that wasn't possible.
It's not just a bunch of technologies thrown together. They're things that you need to have to actually execute on the promises.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, one of the things, and it'd be interesting to hear from you, Ricky, and you, Bijoy, in terms of what you're seeing with your customers, but we obviously heard a big focus here on the enterprise, right? What Sprint's doing, what Boingo can do as we think about connected stadiums and venues, what Verizon's doing. And it's clear why the operators want to focus there, right? It's a new opportunity. How are you seeing that with your customers? And if we think about drilling down below the enterprise to verticals, yeah. Do you see the operators having a good enough understanding of the requirements of the enterprise? Or can you help them on that journey?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think one of the things that we've found, if you think about enterprise, I mean, and verticals, it's huge, right? And I don't think anyone can be an expert in all of those things, right? It's just simply not possible. So I think what we've seen really is two types of strategies. One, which is a broader connectivity-based strategy, which is enable enterprises and verticals to connect and make use of the networks. A good example of that would be our Wing platform, which is a global IoT platform, which one of the large US operators is using. So they can provide IoT connectivity anywhere in the world, irrespective of the vertical that's using it. But then we do see that certain operators are focusing very much on certain industrial segments and verticals. For example, we do a lot of work with some operators in Latin America focused on mining and agriculture. We've got some here in the US, of course, very much focused around automotive sectors who have a long history in providing data in the automotive space. So I see it as a bit of both, broad connectivity and very specialized expertise. And how do we help? Well, we're investing a lot of money in our enterprise channel in actually building R&D and solutions for the enterprise space. And helping build ecosystems. Again, you can't be all things to everybody in this space. And what we're learning that's a little bit different to perhaps how we built 4G is having to work with a lot of other players in the industry to come together, bring their expertise. Because even in Nokia, we've only chosen 5 or 6 verticals as our specialty. And it's a whole new language that we're learning, a whole new way of doing business and understanding their business challenges. So we have to bring that to the operators as well.
I'd say when we look at the space, understanding the different vertical industry requirements and scale requires greater collaboration. And the good thing is, as operators, we see them actually engage a wider variety of these stakeholders. It's not just talking to infrastructure vendors like Nokia, Ericsson, Mavenir, and others. It's also engaging the industry vertical experts. It's understanding their requirements and eventually being able to translate those requirements into new product service offerings. Specifically to your question on understanding these requirements, if we look at it, you could broadly categorize them into the operational, the performance-related ones, and the functional ones. So operational performance ones, if we look at those, to some extent you could say is understood by the operators. But if you look at the functional requirements specific to certain vertical industries, that's where we think greater collaboration needs to happen among the operators to understand what the different vertical industries need. Because, again, strategic focus is going to be key in selecting the right target sectors, because you go after every sector, you end up losing money. And where specifically Mavenir is helping in this, I'll point to a couple of examples on launches that we did recently. At India Mobile Congress, we announced our partnership with Vodafone Idea, one of the largest carriers in the world with more than 400 million subs. What we launched there was a cloud platform, which is automated, and their objective is to launch it as network as a service. And if you look at enterprise verticals and how vertical industries could eventually monetize this, this is a perfect example of how you could open up your network to third parties, to enterprises, to MVNOs, using technologies such as network slicing and others to eventually generate and monetize the network.
Yeah, I think you go back, it is a little bit of the age-old discussion we had, let's say, around IoT with IT versus OT, right? We can understand the IT requirements, the networking side of things, but there's the operational side of things that will vary from manufacturing to utilities. I mean, Asha, obviously, Intel knows you work with these verticals, you work with these enterprises. Do you think there's a disconnect there, or do you think we can actually, whether it's through working with integrators, pulling them in, help the mobile industry to make sure they actually meet those requirements?
I actually think it's a work in progress, and we're very focused on it. In fact, we have entire efforts around engaging the trials, like Ricky was telling, learning the language and all. They don't do bits per bytes per second per meter square and all. But we are making progress and removing constraints. Back to cutting the wires and the flexibility it provides, we start making the deployment models easier. We have a network builders community of 350 companies, ISVs, OSVs, CASPs, everyone, right, TEMS. And so we all come together to look at how do we do the workloads, how do we build all of this together. So it's something that is a community effort, and it's the transition to making the deployment models change the verticals.
So it's interesting, just pivoting a little bit, right? You talk about some of the work you're doing with network builders as a community effort. On a different topic, right, we heard Tammy talk a bit about what we can think of going forward with 5G and technologies to not just serve commercial purposes, but to help communities, right? And to some extent, that's also a vertical requirement, right? Whether that's smart cities or public safety, or you think about education. How are you seeing with the customers you're engaging with or with the market, this focus on technology, 5G for maybe societal good versus just we need to figure out making the business model make sense? Do we need to get the business model sorted before we can think about how we leverage these technologies to help everyone and uplift societies? Or is there a real opportunity to change things? And that's really for anyone who's...
Maybe I'll mm-hmm. go first. I think the straight answer to us, it is yes. You need to sort out the business case, look at it from a location by location basis. So most of the initial engagements we've seen operators engage in is in industrial manufacturing cases or automotive industry. So you could, for those, if you look at 5G hotspots as the initial use case, and make that to make the business case work, and then you could expand after that. Versus if you try to build a full macro network on day one that's justified on a latency use case that's not proven yet, then you end up losing money down the road. So, but at the same time, if you're asking about the great, looking at the greater benefits, you need to look at the greater scope as well, because if you're trying to model 5G and the economic benefits of that, without looking at the greater benefits, you end up losing money, because as all the panelists in the earlier presentations also had, if you don't just see it as a network generation technology transition, but looking at it as a network transformation that encumbers all areas of business, then absolutely you need to look at these greater benefits as well.
Yeah. I mean, I think you remember we have very advanced LTE networks. I know we wanted to talk about 5G, but the reality is the bulk of where the traffic's going to sit for a few more years yet is going to be in the LTE network. So a lot of the things we're doing are actually already building on top of LTE, LTE Advanced, and allowing us to go out to the cities and work with them in terms of, you know, building smart cities and connectivity and autonomous vehicles, all that sort of thing. It's great stuff. So we can do it in parallel. We don't have to wait for 5G. 5G is going to bring some incredible things on top that we can't perhaps do today at scale or economically. But let's not lose sight of the fact that we don't have to wait for 5G. There's a lot we can still do in the interim.
I'm always reminded that anytime we update our forecast, right, and we look forward to our forecast of 2025, and yeah, it's incredible that 2025 we expect 15-20% of connections to be on 5G, but that's a fraction of what will be on LTE, right? And I think we lose sight of the fact that LTE is, I mean, it's such a solid technology and will continue to evolve
exactly,
and provide some opportunity.
Yeah. Yeah, but I like to think about the world beyond phones and the other currencies of 5G. I like to think that technology is predictable, but what people do with it is not. And that's where it's all about removing the constraints. I'd go back to your first question. With AI, you get personalization. So when I look at aging populations and things like telemedicine, we can give custom medicine that reduces the cost of the doctor's visits and hospitals and mobility. So I think they all start coming together because of the currencies of 5G. And in fact, your first question of the cliche will actually be what makes it different from LTE and all of it.
Yeah, I think the 5G has certainly brought that conversation to the forefront. And it's not just about the big cities. I mean, we've been doing work with some of the operators here in the U.S. in the rural cities and the smaller places where, you know, you can start to see the benefits of the technology. So it's not just all about also doing it in the big cities. It's going to be a great increment to providing services in rural parts of America as well.
Yeah, I think of the way we've been looking at it is thinking of 5G obviously as an extension, but going back to this idea that what 4G and LTE enabled, right, was a platform on which innovation could take place, right? That we might not have the Airbnbs and the Ubers of the world if we didn't have that foundation. And so going forward, how can we look at that as a way to not just enable bigger pockets or improve our financial welfare, but look at that as a platform to think about societal change as well?
Yeah, we don't need faster videos of cats. We need real change, right?
We need more. I mean, we need more videos of cats, or at least we need networks because we obviously can't stop those videos from being produced. So I think we've got just about 5 minutes left, and I think what I'd like to ask each of you is, obviously at a show like this where there's a ton going on, right? Lots of different booths, lots of different suppliers here, no shortage of presentations. It's easy to sort of lose sight of some of the cool stuff that's taking place. So taking out what you're showing in your own booth, or you're doing in your own company, what's one thing that you've been excited either to see that you haven't had a chance to see yet, or you've seen while you've been here, maybe as a tip for the rest of us?
I'll start. JWR Wireless, CBRS. CBRS working, and the things that enable mid-band in the U.S.
You can elaborate. We still have 5 minutes.
I'll let others go and then.
I think I didn't get a lot of time to walk around the floor, but a couple of things that interested me was, of course, seeing more of what edge computing is coming to reality. So I saw one of the booths where you had retail stores where you could just walk in and grab something off the shelf and walk out. And this was for these convenience stores that are not open after night during midnight hours, right? So I thought that was an interesting use case for how edge computing could be used. And also the opportunity you talked about 4G continuing to play a significant role in carrying most of the data through the next couple of years. If we think about this opportunity for operators, if the number of local data centers that they have in terms of thousands of those local data centers, those dwarf the number of availability zones that the public cloud providers have today. So in terms of actually monetizing this network and having interesting use cases that affect the society at the end of the day is going to be valuable to all of us as a society, especially if you're trying to get rid of the rural divide in the country that's already there for even for 4G.
Yeah, I think I can quickly, before we hand over to you, Ricky, I think I can attest, having moderated a session on Edge yesterday and another one today, Edge is clearly a topic that is huge here. CBRS, we're seeing the initial commercial deployments mm-hmm. not too long ago. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we were hoping that we would have seen those last year at Mobile World Congress at MWC Los Angeles, but it's here now. So that's clearly two big things. Hopefully, you all have seen that. If not, please go take a look. Ricky, what do you think?
Yeah, haven't had a chance to get out of the booth yet, but what I always like to do at these shows is go beyond the traditional handset devices and go and see what else is being connected to the networks, because that shows where the innovation is coming from. So connected devices, connected tools, entertainment. So how are people thinking about utilizing the 5G technology? So there's some just crazy stuff that's going to be out there that you never think about. Going back to the earlier point is that we didn't think of the Airbnbs and these other things when we built 4G. But I think already people are starting to think about, well, what could 5G bring to us? So I think there's already early innovations coming. And it's always great to go out and see what kind of crazy stuff's out there.
Yeah,
not sure if it ever makes money, but there's some pretty cool stuff.
No, but I mean, I think that's the question of experimentation, right? That the experimentations that we saw on the app side of things, what we should be able to see going forward on 5G, that is, I think it's what we're all looking for. So, any last thoughts before we hand it back?
Make 5G a reality.
Yeah, we're just busy building. It's exciting times.
I guess that one last question for me is next year. I mean, hopefully we'll all be here next year. Where do you think we'll be with 5G next year?
I think we'll continue to build on the edge, right? Next year will be all about how the network provides different experiences, whether you're a business or whether you're, you're in a household, around personalization. Next year, I think we'll make that cliche come through with live examples of how the network brings all these things together.
I think that's a great thought.
I was looking at the theme for the conference, intelligent connectivity. I was at the India Mobile Congress last week, and there they had three I's in there: immersive, intelligence, and inclusiveness. So inclusiveness there meant not just bringing the urban areas, but bringing the rural areas also into the whole ecosystem, making them succeed as well. So I'm seeing increasingly, and I'm expecting next year as well, as 5G rollouts happen, we should hear more of that in the discussions.
Yeah, I think by this time next year, we should really start to see some true traction in terms of the industrialization and in the enterprise space. I think it's still very early days, lots of trials. We need to work out how we help the operators and others that are coming into the business, perhaps through CBRS. How do we productize this in such a way that we can make it economical to deploy quickly so that not every new opportunity is a custom build? I think that's something hopefully within 12 months, we'll start to have some momentum behind doing that.
Wonderful. Well, with that, let me say thank you to the panel, but thank you to you all for being here. I've been asked to give a reminder of one right after this in just a few minutes. I think it's 15 minutes. There'll be the CTO panel, a CTO session. So please stick around for that. Obviously, reach out to us if you have any questions about what we've been talking about. I can just put in a quick plug. My team is running a seminar on private wireless networks as we think about the enterprise side of things and what we can see with 5G or 4G today. We think private networks are a huge opportunity. Check it out on the agenda. Please show up if you'd like to check it out. But with that, can we have a round of applause for the panelists?
Thank you.
Great. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.